Hello, in this video, I'd like to introduce the concept of a counter machine. Counter machines are an alternative to Turing machines. They're a mathematical model of computation that's Turing complete. And so we're interested in two tasks, primarily using them to prove that a particular programming language is Turing complete by implementing counter machines in them, and occasionally also implementing something with counter machines. And generally, counter machines are easier for both uses. A counter machine consists of a finite number of registers, which can each store arbitrary natural numbers. In order to be Turing complete, it's essential that our model of computation be able to store arbitrary amounts of data. Otherwise, it's a finite state automaton. In the case of Turing machines, they provide arbitrary amounts of memory by having an infinitely long tape of positions that can only take on finitely many values, usually a 0 or a 1. This is kind of the opposite. There are only finitely many positions, but they can take on infinitely many values. It's infinite in a different direction. A particular counter machine will also have a finite list of instructions, some sort of assembly language-like code that describes their operation. The allowed instructions are to increment a particular register, so add one to the value stored in it, decrement a particular register, so subtract one from its value, and of course, if it already contains a zero, then we can't subtract one. All of these registers have to contain natural numbers, so if it already contains zero, then just do nothing. It's useful to think of our registers as buckets that contain some number of counters in them, and these operations add and remove the counters. We have a go-to instruction, so when we read this instruction, we'll jump to a particular line of our code. We have a conditional go-to, so if register J has a zero stored in it, then and only then will we jump to line K. This is our only real way of getting information out of the registers, but it turns out that it's enough. And then we have a halt instruction. As soon as we reach this instruction, we stop executing the program. And that's it. It's a very small and simple language, but you can still use it to compute whatever you want. These sorts of machines are Turing complete. So let's take a look at a simple setup. We'll start with just one register, R0, which let's say starts out with the value 3 in it. And we have this program here. By convention, we start out at instruction 0, a conditional jump. The contents of register 0 aren't 0, so we just go on to the next instruction. Now, we decrement, if we can, the contents of register 0, so after this, it will contain a 2. Now we jump back to line 0, creating a loop. Register 0 is still not empty, so we continue. Subtracting 1 and looping. And if we keep doing this, eventually register 0 is going to be empty, so we jump to line 3 and thus halt. This is a simple program that clears out the contents of register R0, right? We're subtracting 1 in a loop until the register is empty. In figuring out how to write programs to do certain tasks with counter machines, it's useful to be able to use programs we've already written as part of other programs. For instance, let's say we wanted to use our previous program to clear out register 0 before moving the contents of register 1 into register 0. We see this loop between lines 1 and 4 repeatedly moves one counter, one unit of value, from register R1 to R0 until R1 is empty. So how could we take this pseudocode and translate it into the proper language of a register machine? Well, first we bring in our program that sets R0 to 0. And then we merge these two programs together. This is going to change the numbering of the lines of code in our subroutine, so we're going to have to change the line numbers in the relevant go-tos. Then we change our line 0, where we wanted to call our subroutine, to be a go-to to the start of our subroutine. And finally, we replace the halt at the end of our subroutine with a jump back to the original program, the line after we called our subroutine. This is neat. It feels like we're looking into the deep processes of putting together machine code. For instance, this process of relocation, having to adjust the line numbers of pieces of code, and thus having to adjust the corresponding go-tos, is essential for running multiple programs on a system at the same time. A program won't know in advance where in memory it's going to be stored, and so the exact position of each of its line numbers is uncertain until it's been loaded. This process of translating subroutines into machine code gets a little bit trickier if we want to call our subroutine from many different places in our program, and a lot trickier if we want to call it recursively. But anyway, this particular program we constructed isn't ideal. It moves the contents of R1 into R0, leaving R1 empty when we're done. More likely, we just want to copy the contents of R1 into R0, leaving the value stored in R1 alone so we can use it again later. I'll let you pause the video for a moment in case you want to try to figure out how to write a program that copies the contents of register R1 into register R0 without losing the original value in R1. It's a very fun puzzle, so I encourage you to try. While you're at it, see if you can figure out how to add or multiply the contents of two registers. And if you're really ambitious, try to implement your own Turing machine. The idea is simple. We need to get another register involved. Let's say R2, but if this is part of a larger program where R2 is already used, we need to pick some register that isn't used anywhere else in the code. We're allowed to do this, but only finitely many times because we're only allowed finitely many registers. First, we empty out our register R0. And again, this is a subroutine thing. This is shorthand for a longer program. This first loop repeatedly removes one counter from R1 while adding one counter to R0 and R2. When the loop finishes, when R1 is empty, the value stored in both R0 and R2 will be the original value in R1. So we've moved the value in R1 to R0, but this time we have a backup copy of that value in R2 as well that we can restore to R1. So this second loop does just that. Empty out R2 into R1 to restore the original value of R1. Note that if we didn't clear out R0 at the beginning, this would add the value of R1 to R0 instead, which is another very useful subroutine. It's worth noting that just as you might find slight variations in the definition of Turing machine, for instance, is the read-write head allowed to not move on a particular turn, or must it always move either left or right? And these slight variations don't impact what constitutes Turing complete. There are also variations on the definition of a counter machine, and also different names, like register machine or Minsky machine. For instance, some definitions might include possible instructions that clear a register or copy one register to another, but we've seen that we can get by without them. Having more available instructions makes it easier to write practical counter machine programs, while having fewer available instructions makes it easier to implement counter machines in a particular programming language. Let me give you an idea how we can implement a basic recursive function like multiplication. Suppose we want to store the value of R1 times R2 in R0, leaving R1 and R2 alone. Again, we'll start by clearing out R0, and then we'll copy the value in R2 to R3, so that we don't modify the value in R2. And then we can loop. In each loop, we're going to add a copy of R1 to our accumulated total in R0, and we're going to decrement R3 until R3 is empty. This means that in all, we will be adding R1 to R0 once for each value originally stored in R2. And you can use this sort of process to execute whatever code you want a number of times given by the contents of a register. Through this sort of iteration, you can do repeated multiplication to compute exponents. It's a fun puzzle to try to get division with remainders to work. It's mostly just counting the number of times you can do repeated subtraction, but the tricky part is correctly recovering when the last subtraction fails. Remember that the goal of studying counter machines was that they were Turing complete. We can use them to carry out any computation we want. You may be skeptical as to whether counter machines are genuinely Turing complete, so let me spell out a sketch of the proof here. I'll link to some sources where you can find more detailed proofs in the description. First, we're going to need to store the tape of the Turing machine. Let's say that at any point during its operation, the tape is going to have some finite number of zeros and ones on it, followed by infinitely many zeros. We can represent this as a binary number and store that binary number in a single register. The only tricky thing is that the digits of a binary number are infinite in to the left as opposed to the right. So we're kind of doing things a little bit backwards here. We'll also need registers to store the current state of the Turing machine and the current position of the read-write head. Although if you're clever, you can actually store the state of the Turing machine in the current line of code that you're on, which I think is more appropriate. Then we construct a next step subroutine. This subroutine begins by calculating 2 to the power of the current position index of the tape. This gives us a handle on the tape at the current position. If we take the number of the tape and divide it by 2 to the position, we get the tape at and beyond the current position, and then by checking if this number is even or odd, we can determine if the symbol at the current position is a 0 or 1. These are both division with remainder operations, which is a thing that you can do with these sorts of machines. The proof is a little bit tricky, but again, I'll link you to some resources down below. We can then do conditionals on the current state and the current symbol to determine what to do. Maybe increment or decrement the current position, and if necessary, add or subtract our 2 to the position number that we got to change the symbol on the tape. Either add it to turn a 0 into a 1, or subtract it to turn a 1 into a 0. Then we repeatedly apply this next step subroutine until we reach a halt state. So hopefully this gives you an idea of how to implement a Turing machine using a counter machine, and again, I'll link to proofs in the description. As I mentioned, there's lots of different variations on the precise definition of these sorts of machines, but one with a fascinating insight has only 3 possible instructions. Increment with jump, which takes in a register and a line number, increments the register, and jumps to that line of code. So it's kind of like an instruction that does 2 things. And then we have a decrement with jump, which takes in a register and 2 line numbers. So this is a conditional decrement. It decrements the register and jumps to one of the 2 lines depending on whether the decrement was successful or not. That is, if the register originally contained a 0, then the decrement failed, and so we should go to the second of the 2 lines, and otherwise we go to the first. And, of course, halt. So this type of alternative counter machine has just these 3 commands, and then you have to prove that a program in our original language, which we knew was Turing complete, can be translated into a program in this new language, and vice versa. This type of counter machine is often called a Minsky machine. So, for instance, if we have our sample program that clears out register 0, we can translate it as follows. To translate a conditional jump, we write it as first a decrement with conditional jump to detect if our register started empty, and then an increment with jump to restore the value in the register in case it wasn't empty and we accidentally subtracted 1 from it. By default, we're just jumping to the next line, but I've had to translate the goto 3 into a goto 4 because I've had to renumber the line slightly. Next, we have a decrement. We can translate it into a decrement with jump command where we jump to the next line regardless of whether the decrement was a success or not. Next, we have our goto, and there's several different ways of translating this. For instance, we can pick an unused register and decrement that, and regardless of the outcome, although ideally this unused register should start out empty, we jump to the line that we want. And finally, we keep our halt instruction the same. There's even better ways of translating this particular program, but hopefully this gives you a sense of how we can do this translation in general. The translation back is even easier. But the clever thing here is that with this new programming language, the order of the lines of code doesn't matter. Nowhere do we care about what the next line of code is or what the previous line of code is. We can shuffle the lines around, and as long as we fix up all of the line numbers in our jumps, it'll still work the same. And so we can think of these lines of code as, instead of having an ordered structure to them, just abstract points in space, and connect them based on what they tell us to do. The result will be a state diagram, similar to the diagrams for finite state automata. And that's the clever insight. Which line of code we're on acts a lot like a state, and states act a lot like which line of code we're on. We construct our state diagram as follows. First, we draw an arrow into the start state, the state corresponding to the first line of code, line 0. Then, because line 0 is a decrement with conditional jump, we actually need to draw two arrows. If our decrement is a success, we'll jump to state 1. I'll label this arrow with an R0 minus to indicate that we're decrementing R0. If our decrement fails, on the other hand, because R0 contains 0, we'll jump instead to state 4. I'll label this arrow with an R0 question mark to indicate that the decrement of R0 failed. Next, state 1 is an increment, so there's just one state to jump to. I'll label the arrow with an R0 plus to indicate that we're incrementing register 0. And then we can add our pairs of arrows for states, really lines 2 and 3. And finally, I've drawn the circle for state 4 with a double border to indicate that it's a halt state. Again, note that this looks a lot like a state transition diagram, again with lines of code corresponding to states. There are some subtleties here. The state of a finite state automaton contains all of the information the machine is storing, while our counter machines also store information in the registers. What line of code we're on is much more akin to the state of a Turing machine. A Turing machine's state describes what it's currently doing, but there's also the information stored on the tape of the Turing machine, which kind of corresponds to the contents of the registers. There are a huge number of variations of this sort of counter machine that are Turing complete. And I argue that counter machines are really ideal for proving that other programming languages are Turing complete. You can easily show, for instance, that Fractran is Turing complete by translating counter machines into Fractran. And in a future video, I'll show that Diophantine equations are Turing complete by translating counter machines into those. So I hope that you'll join me for that. In the meantime, please leave any questions or comments you have down below, and be kind to each other.